Hi, my name is Paul Barr. I'm a health service researcher originally from Ireland, and I've been working at the Dartmouth Institute for around 6 years now. So what gets me out of bed in the morning for my work is trying to improve patient and family engagement in their care, and doing so by improving how we communicate with them through the use of technology. Today I'm going to tell you guys about some technology that I'm developing that I fundamentally believe will change how we deliver healthcare in America and indeed internationally. So first, what I want to do is to have you just imagine yourselves in one of these three clinical scenarios. So first of all, imagine you're a 41-year-old woman who's just received a diagnosis of breast cancer. So your clinician's talking to you about this diagnosis, the treatment options, the prognosis, the outlook. You're thinking about, how do I tell my kids? So now a second scenario, imagine you're the son of an older adult who lives in New Hampshire with multiple conditions that he's really struggling to manage, but you live in San Francisco. You really care for your dad and you want to be engaged in his care and help him out, but the distance is such a big barrier that you find it really hard to stay on top of what's going on with him. And then finally, think of yourself as a parent and you have a 6-month-old daughter who's developed a rash and maybe some lumps in the back of her head. So you're going to go to visit with your pediatrician, but your partner can't make it. And they have a list of questions they want you to ask. So you're in the visit, and you're asking the questions, and the doctor's giving you the answers. And you're trying to remember the questions while listening to the answers, and try to take all that on board while you have a 6-month-old there crying. These situations aren't uncommon. And most of the time, really important clinical information is being exchanged. But as soon as the door's closed and we walk out, we leave confused. And we find it hard to remember what it was that was actually discussed. In fact, up to 80% of information that's discussed during a clinic visit is forgotten almost immediately after we walk out the door. And that's common across every single visit in the US. So there is a solution. And guess what? The solution is in pretty much all of our pockets. I bet it's in your two pockets right now. High-powered recording devices that can capture the actual clinic visit verbatim. It's a comprehensive record of what was discussed that you can listen back to. Not surprisingly, patients are taking the lead on this and starting to actually record their visits. What may be surprising is that doctors are getting engaged in this too and encouraging patients to record visits. They see the benefit. The big barrier we have at the moment is that this isn't routine yet. And so patients feel pretty anxious about asking if they can record. And they'd rather ask for forgiveness than permission, and then they end up recording secretly. So earlier I mentioned about the girl. Well, my daughter is Layla, and she was 6 months old at the time, and we had this problem with a rash and lumps in her head. Turns out it was nothing to be concerned about, some swollen lymph nodes, which is apparently pretty common. We didn't know that, and my wife couldn't make the visit. So she gave me a list of questions, and when I was there, I was thinking, you know, I'm doing this recording research. Maybe I'll ask if I can record. And I've known this doctor for 6 years. He's my son's pediatrician. But the anxiety I felt, I was talking myself out of asking for permission over and over until the doctor sat down and I eventually built up the courage to say, yep, can I, you know, would it be okay if I recorded this? I can't make the visit and there's so much information. And he said, of course. Turn the recorder on. I want you to take this information home. The recording lasted around 16 minutes. I sent it to my wife by text message. She listened back and told me I forgot some things to ask the doctor, of course, so it was a pretty worthwhile recording. So my time over the last few years has really involved developing a research group called the Open Recordings Group. And we're interested in studying the implications and applications of recordings in healthcare. And we've been doing pretty well so far. We've published some pretty important papers in high-impact journals like JAMA and the British Medical Journal. And we've also been picked up by some mainstream media outlets like the New York Times, interested in the work that we're doing. Now, through the research that we've been undertaking, we realize there's a better way of offering recordings to patients and clinicians, which will make this much more open and trustworthy. And so we have set about the last 2.5 years developing a secure, easy to use recording platform, an application called AudioPal. Now, the neat thing about AudioPal is that we're working with data scientists to use cutting edge machine learning technology that will allow us to not only share a recording with a patient to listen to at home, but actually search through that recording and identify for the patient the key information so they don't have to struggle trying to go back through it again. And even more so, when we identify that information, say the new medication, we're creating hyperlinks out to trustworthy, credible information that's written in patient terms, lay terms, that they can then bring back in and start to create a personal health library. Now, we've received funding from the National Library of Medicine and from the Gordon Met Betty Moore Foundation to do this. Our funding allows us to develop this system. Our funding doesn't allow us to disseminate and implement this system. It's the nature of research. We get funding for certain projects. And what I'm asking you for today is to invest in this project to help us bring it to the next step of dissemination and implementation. We don't want this to be another project that sits on the shelf. We truly believe this could change the face of healthcare, and it is the future of healthcare, and we want you to help us actually deliver this future. So thank you for listening. I'll take any questions.
So first of all, thank you for being here today, and that was a great presentation. So I was actually that 41-year-old woman who got the diagnosis of breast cancer. It was 8 years ago. And it never occurred to me to have anybody there with me or have a recording when I was getting that diagnosis. So I'm very excited about this project. So my question for you is, where do you see this going 5 to 10 years from now? What does a success look like for you?
Sure, I'm really sorry to hear about the diagnosis, and I'm glad obviously we're here things must have went well. Undoubtedly, the future of healthcare will be recorded data, not just for the patient and family side, which I'm really interested in, but also for the clinicians. We have new powerful artificial intelligence, and that's going to enable us to populate electronic medical records, to help with diagnosis and suggesting treatment plans for patients, but we need data to do that. And the data we will use will be the recording of the visit that will reduce documentation burden for clinicians and reduce clinician burnout. The recordings can be used by patients in a system like ours so they can listen back and better understand what it is, what that was discussed, so they can be better engaged in their care. So 5 to 10 years from now, I think we're just going to see recording implemented more and more and more. And we already have health systems interested in working with us to implement this sort of system. And technology companies like Amazon and Microsoft have been reaching out to us to ask us about our system and whether or not we're ready to demo it, which we're just a little bit off doing, but we're not too far away. We do have a prototype.
Technology is moving really fast. And one of the big issues now is the integrity and the security of data. What you're talking about is federally protected personal health information. How do you get around some of the issues that have come up recently, particularly with DNA evidence, where you have third parties having access to PHI? And how do you maintain that security and keep people who don't have, under the way the current law is written, privilege and access to get to that data?
There's a long answer to that, which we would need a lot more time to go through, but some of the thoughts I'm having on this is one, that we currently don't have any true regulations or policies to guide recording in clinic practice. We're working off old wiretapping laws. And so we need to update that, and we need to get a group of key stakeholders, patients, caregivers, clinicians, health administrators, data scientists, to gather in a room to think through all the possibilities of this type of data, the potential and the pitfalls. Secondly, I understand there is concern with recording, absolutely. You hear your voice. There are clinics in America that are doing this right now. I've been there and I've studied these clinics in Texas, clinics in Phoenix, clinics in Michigan. None of these clinics have ever reported being taken for a lawsuit based on a recording. Patients aren't recording to capture bad practice. They're recording to help them understand what was discussed. And in fact, in Phoenix, health insurance companies are now offering clinicians who record their visits a 10% reduction in malpractice insurance and a $1 million increase in liability coverage if they record the visit. So they see it as a benefit to record the visit. In terms of protecting the data, We have the ability to protect data, but we just need the regulations in order to think of how we will do this in this changing world with this artificial intelligence and the use of recorded data. So it's still something to be figured out, but there are solutions there. We just need to get together and really hammer them out.
How much of an investment are you looking for to get the implementation that you're talking about?
we're probably looking to close to $1 million. We have quite a large, with a project like this, we have a health service research team, informatics, data science, we have patient partners, we have caregivers. So it's an extensive multidisciplinary team. And you know, I wish we could do it with less, but it really is just a challenge to do so. And that's just the limitation of research grants, where we do have limited budgets to do certain things. And so with the budget we have at the moment, it's just developing and showing proof of concept and being able to do a pilot study with the project in a small setting. And we're doing that in Dartmouth Hitchcock quite soon.
Thank you. That's great. Thank you very much.
Good luck. Awesome.